The readings for this morning are based on the Stations of the Cross, a devotion that was developed in the Middle Ages by the Franciscan monks as a way of allowing people who could not travel to the Holy Land to walk where Christ walked on the day of his passion. By the end of the 17th century, many churches had stations or stops ranged at intervals along their walls, each with a cross, and under that cross, a representation of an event in the Passion narrative. Today, there are still many Christians across the world who praise these stations during Lent and Holy Week. God's love for us should be overwhelming to us. His willingness to sacrifice his Son shows us his immense love for us, his creation. As we gather to remember the Passion of Jesus, we focus not only on the agony of the cross, but upon God's victory through the crucified. Even more, we lift high the cross as a sign of God's triumph over sin, death, and evil.
Station one, Jesus is condemned to death. The cries of crucify him, still ring in my ears. The picture of Pilate sitting on the judge's bench, asking the crowd of leaders and people, shall I crucify your king? And their response, we have no king but the emperor, is an image that haunts me. It haunts me because of the callousness and injustice of it all. The world is so often unjust, but mostly it haunts me because I see this injustice, this callousness in myself. And often I wonder now, did I participate in allowing an innocent person to suffer? Often, did I judge and dismiss persons as unworthy, as not due my care or compassion? How often did I take part in carrying out the judgment of others without question, without thought, without even a tear?
Let us ever walk with Jesus, follow his example pure, through a world that would deceive us, and to sin our spirits lure. Onward in his footsteps treading, travelers hear our home above. To our Savior's bidding, faithful Lord, we may abide. I shall follow where you guide. Let us suffer here with Jesus, and with patience bear our cross. Joy will follow all our sexness, where he is, there is no loss. Though today we sow no laughter, we shall reap celestial joy. All discomforts that annoy shall give way to mirth hereafter. Jesus, here I share your woe. Help me there your joy to know.
Station two, Jesus accepts his cross. He went out carrying his cross like so many others before him, beaten by my brothers, mocked by my guard, bent over, bleeding, a horrible sight that people fail to see even as they gather on the streets to gossip and to stare. A sight that we, his executioners, close our hearts to, lest we somehow end up feeling the pain, the burden, that the one who is afflicted must carry. Humanity is burdened with many crosses, war, hunger, and famine, greed and poverty, sickness and death. Everywhere you look, there are people who bear these crosses, people who are afflicted, people whom we look at but do not see, people struggling alone. This Jesus, he walked that road of sorrow, like so many before him, alone, carrying the burden that he did not earn, without a word, in silence.
On a hill far away stood the old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And I love that old cross where the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners I slain. So I'll cherish thy old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to thy
Station 3, Jesus meets his mother. The look on her face, I could tell that she was his mother. Such anguish and pain as she looked upon him and he upon her. I could not tell what they said to one another in that glance. Whatever it was, she stood there in anguish, tears pouring from her eyes. What mother would not feel agony, the agony of Mary's helplessness and sense of loss? What father would not care? Yet in a world filled with death and destruction, from wars and earthquakes, from riots and terror to drought and starvation, so many seem to have lost the ability to comprehend and feel compassion in the face of loss, unless it is our own.
Station 4, Simon Cyrene helps Jesus carry the cross. It was the only thing to do, a thing we have done 100 times. A perfect stranger coming into the city just happened to be at the wrong place at the wrong time. I demanded that he be grabbed and forced to take hold of the cross. Was he reluctant? Better to ask, was I? I longed to help Jesus, but I was afraid. I was relieved when the guards picked someone out of the crowd to help. I was ashamed that I could not bring myself to step out of character, out of my role, to help the man.
Jesus, friend of sinners. Jesus, friend of sinners, we have strayed so far away. We cut down people in your name, but the sword was never ours to swing. Jesus, friend of sinners, the truth's become so hard to see. The world is on their way to you, but they're tripping over me. Always looking around, but never looking up. I'm so double-minded. A plank-eyed saint with dirty hands and a heart divided. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours. Verse 2. Jesus, friend of sinners, the one who's writing in the sand, made the righteous turn away and the stones fall from their hands. Help us to remember we are all the least of these. Let the memory of your mercy bring your people to their knees. Nobody knows what we're for, only what we're against. When we judge the wounded, what if we put down our signs, crossed over the lines, and loved like you did? Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, open our eyes to the world at the end of our pointing fingers. Let our hearts be led by mercy. Help us reach with open hearts and open doors. Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours.
Jesus, friend.
Oh, Jesus, friend of sinners, break our hearts for what breaks yours.
Station 5, Jesus speaks to the weeping women. They cry, these women who follow us, like I am crying inside. But our tears are not enough. They cannot stop the agony. They cannot feed the hungry. They cannot bring peace. They cannot stop this evil from happening. Jesus speaks to them, barely heard over their wailing. If you must weep, he says, weep for yourselves and your children. I can hardly understand what he means. Is it a word of judgment or of compassion? Or somehow both? I think it's the later. that this man knows what is happening to him and that it will be soon over, but that their suffering and the suffering of their children is yet to come. Oh, that there was another way. There is another way. I know it in my heart. We must move beyond weeping. We must also act, but I cannot. I am as powerless as this man bent over under his cross.
Follow to thy judgment hall, will the Lord of life arraigned. O the wormwood and the gall, O the pangs his soul sustained, shun not suffering, shame, or loss. Learn from him to bear the cross. Calvary's mournful mountain climb, there adoring at his feet, mark that miracle of time, God's own sacrifice complete. It is finished, hear him cry, learn from Jesus Christ to die.
Station 6, Jesus is stripped of his garments. We stripped him. Our job is to make sure that there is nothing left to a man to mark him as a man, to expose him, to humiliate him, to reduce him to the equivalent of the garbage that litters the shallow valley just below this hill. We did our job. Some of my men with more glee than others, wondering who would get his robe, a robe that, despite the blood and the grime and the wrens, might fetch a good price. Jesus just stands there, swaying, with nothing. Is this his poverty, or is it ours that I see? We took his clothes, we took his dignity, much like this world strips naked hundreds and thousands of its people every day with its greed and its uncaring. Yet, in some strange way, I find myself caring more than I ever have before. I want nothing to do with taking his clothing. I will let the men gamble for it after we nail this Jesus to the cross.
I'm the one who held the nail. It was cold between my fingertips. I've hidden in the garden. I've denied you with my very lips. I've done things I wish I hadn't done. I've seen things I wish I hadn't seen. Just the thought of your amazing grace, and I cried, Jesus, forgive me. God, I fall down to my knees with a hammer in my hand. You look at me, arms open, forgiven, forgiven. Child, there is freedom from all of it. Say goodbye to every sin. You are forgiven.
Station 7, Jesus is nailed to the cross. The ring of the hammer on the nails, I'll never, never, ever forget this. Somehow this one crucifixion is different than all the others I've been to. The torture, for that's what it was, has not stopped. It still happens every day. From utter brutality to the unkind word that flays the soul, it still happens. But not the nonchalance, the ease with which my soldiers threw the dice beneath his feet as if nothing were happening, horrifies me today. But then, well then, it was a blessed distraction to hear them chattering and laughing, and to not have to listen to the sounds of weeping as Jesus and the others hung on their crosses.
Jesus dies on the cross. I watched Jesus die. It was unnaturally dark during the time he spent dying, but I saw enough, more than enough. I saw what the sign said that was nailed above his head. I heard what the passerby said about him as they mocked him. And I heard the words that he spoke to his mother and his friend, and what he said to the thief on the cross next to him. I heard all his cries. I saw his agony. Indeed, I was there when he breathed his last with a great cry. Violence and death. I hung my head. I could no longer see for the tears that flowed like his blood down my face. And I could not stop the words that came to my lips, as unbidden as the tears. Truly, this man was God's son. Why did I have a hand in this? How could I have left it happen?
Reading from Luke. Now there was a good and righteous man named Joseph, who, though a member of the council, had not agreed to their plan and action. He came from the Jewish town of Arimathea and was waiting expectantly for the kingdom of God. This man went to Pilate and asked for the body of Jesus. Then he took it down, wrapped it in a linen cloth, and laid it in a rock-hewn tomb where no one had ever been laid. It was the day of preparation, and the Sabbath was beginning. The women who had come with him from Galilee followed, and they saw the tomb and how his body was laid. Then they returned and prepared spices and ointments. On the Sabbath, they rested according to the commandment. Here ends our gospel. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, Heavenly Father, through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. How often have we been here with Jesus on Palm Sunday? We join with those crowds of disciples proclaiming, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord, who shouts Hosanna, who waves palms in joy." How often have we been here as King Jesus comes to Jerusalem to be crowned, not with that crown, not with the golden crown of the kingdom or of the empire, but with a crown of thorns, with blood that offers us salvation and peace. It is said that as Jesus walked, or as he rode in to Jerusalem on that son, on that day, he cried. He paused before he entered into Jerusalem, the very city that means peace, that should have heard, that should have understood what he was saying, what he was trying to do, accepted the peace that he had offered, and yet didn't. They didn't. We didn't. God came to gather and offer his peace by sending his son into this world to heal the lame, to feed the hungry, to drive out demons, to calm the storms, to raise the dead. Over and over again, he showed signs. He offered peace. They kept questioning, kept doubting, kept opposing Jesus. But it's easy, isn't it? It's easy to see someone else's unwillingness to God's will than it is our own. We disciples would never willingly reject and oppose God's will, would we? Peter didn't think so. Peter, the devout, the rock, the one who was there to ask those challenging questions, yet the one who flat out rejected God's plan that would save humanity. That saves us. We have all been in that place where our lives are unwilling to conform to God's will. The unwillingness that is wrapped up in what happens through this process this week as Jesus goes into Jerusalem, as he is arrested and abused. We as humans go through that process. There are moments when we shout Hosanna, when we are there uplifted, joyful, and yet in the next breath shout Crucify. Sometimes in the same day. That's where we swing. And yet God's faith, God's love, isn't fickle or flimsy or faltering. God's love is steadfast for us. And if you have any doubt, any question about it, you look at the man in the middle cross. Here is where we see God's love. Here, at Jesus' own discomfort and anguish, pain and grief, here is where Jesus opens his arms and lifts them up so that we may know the breadth of God's love for each of us. So that we who often are so unwilling see a Savior who was willing to go to the cross, to take on that punishment and that pain for us, so that we may know the breadth that Jesus was willing to go to show us God's love that comes down. It's been a long Lenten season. It's been a long few years. It has been a long process, and it continues to be being shaped by God's love and by God's peace. And so, as we have many times before, may we come to the cross perhaps with a new perspective. We see God differently this day, this week. May we see where God's love comes. Because God's love comes among the crowd, whose shouts change from Hosanna to crucify. God's love comes among the Roman soldiers who stretch out his arms, who hold him down as the hammer meets the nail. God's love comes among the criminals who on either side call out and whom Jesus invites into newness of life. God's love comes among the leaders who smile in smug satisfaction, thinking they have won. They have defeated Jesus. They have defeated the challenge of their authority because they have the high moral ground. But God's love comes when Jesus speaks, "Forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." God's love comes among us as we struggle with each other, as we allow politics and divisive rhetoric to seek to divide us, claiming an us versus them. God's love comes here. As we sit, as we stand, as we bow low, as we drop in exhaustion at the foot of the cross, as we watch, as we mourn, as we wonder, as we ask, why didn't he save himself? As he willingly went like this. God's love comes to the cross to show us just how far God goes for humanity, to show God's love for all of us. And so as we go through this week, as we hear again about the Lord's last meal with his disciples, as we walk to the cross, to the tomb and beyond, may we take some of that love, some of that peace, some of that compassion that God shows us here. May we take that into the world with us as we wait.